is about the shock of cultures coming together in our world today. Culture shock is the change that is thrust on someone before they've had time to fully absorb it and adjust. Culture shock is living next door to someone whose language and ideas represent a challenge to our assumptions about who we think we are. We at Culture Shock want to stimulate your interest in all the people and ideas around you. Culture Shock intends to be a forum where people of the world can voice their thoughts and feelings about their vision of a multicultural society.
Hi, my name is Ian Moore. Welcome to another segment of Culture Shock. My guest today is Piri Thomas, whose book, Down These Mean Streets, told the bold story of his life being raised in Spanish Harlem in the 30s and 40s. A survivor of the Malcolm X generation, his life parallels many of the same struggles of the slain political leader. More recently, Piri has written a book of short stories called Stories from El Barrio. They've been called tender, powerfully compassionate, and a voice for unity. Today, Piri is writing another book called The Question of Human Dignity. Welcome, Piri. As a man of African and Spanish ancestry, what is your most significant culture shock?
I believe it was when I came into my age of awareness, which is about 6 or 7, starting to have a clarity of thought, that after getting up for so many young years in an auditorium in a school, dressed in a white shirt and a red tie and blue trousers, and with my hand over my heart pledging allegiance to the flag that had liberty and justice for all, and then going out to those streets, into the world, and learning to see people who would look at you and for no other reason despise you because of your lovely color. It was an identity crisis in my family with me because my mother was fairer, Puerto Ricans are all different blends, because every country who invaded Puerto Rico in the centuries past, it took the women with or without permission. And so that was also culture clash to me. What was I? Was I African, or was I Taino, or was I of the blood of the conquerors?
So when did you first think of yourself as an African then?
I've always in my heart really thought of myself as an African with a Puerto Rican accent. Mm-hmm. Because I do remember many years ago I was shipping out in the Merchant Marine and I took a bus to go to Virginia. I was just a kid, you know, 17 years old or so. And when we got to the Mason-Dixon line, a northern driver got off and a southern driver got on. It was nothing more than a deputy sheriff. Mm-hmm. And the sign went right up there and it said, you know, hey, it said all the colors in the back. And like I didn't move, you know, and others didn't move. And then he said, got real bad about it. And he said, hey, I said all niggas to the back. And so the truth of it was, because it's happened many times before to others, I'm sure, was that when he said old niggas in the back, I remained there. Certainly I wasn't a nigger. About my brownness, of course that was me. And so I said, hey, I'm not a nigger, you know, I'm a Puerto Rican. And he looked at me, he said, boy, he said, I don't care what kind of a nigger you are, get to the back of the bus. Now, that was a pretty heavy culture shock there, especially after with liberty and justice for all.
Did you spend any time going to Puerto Rico? Have you been and traveled there?
I never saw Puerto Rico, mm-hmm. my brother Ian, until I was the age of 32. Mm-hmm. But I knew of Puerto Rico from the storytellers that were my tribe, my family, my mother. They would sit and speak of Puerto Rico, Ponce, Mayagüez, energy, dignity, independence, all the feelings of what? Because politically we were just a little cog of the United States. We were taken as a colony. And in 1898, and called the Commonwealth, which was a colony in disguise. And Commonwealth, I do believe, is more appropriate because the common came to us and the wealth went to them, in that sense of feeling.
That's a good idea.
So when you see me on Culture Shock, I think I started to get over it when I really began to And it's little funny things that get your mind straight to here and there. And my was fighting so painfully to find out what I was. I would see Puerto Ricans darker than me signing applications and putting race, putting white, Puerto Rican. And I said, mm-hmm. Papito, can you see in the mirror? You know mm-hmm. what we are. But I didn't know where to give my loyalties to that energy. And I think I read one day from some Caucasian philosopher, and this is the truth because I repeated so many times, Popeye the Sailor Man, who said, I am what I am because that's what I am. And I said, well, yeah, that's good enough for me. So I can deal, I feel I've done experiments dealing with my different bloods, you know, to see if it makes me feel any different to be African, any different to be Puerto Rican, or any different to be of that Spanish blood of the conquerors. Who
well, that's an interesting point. The that combination often is looked upon, certainly by the more the Anglo-Saxon society, is when you mix anything, you dilute it to some kind of purity. But myself, being mixed blood, I've always seen that connection being actually a liberating thing. What do you think about that?
I agree 100%. If I meet the vibrations of a friendly white person, immediately I feel the energy of their enemies and senses. I feel the black energy, I feel it there also. I feel Puerto Rican energy there, you know. It was nothing for me to say conglomeration of a manifestation once I learned the words. And it was very natural for me as a child growing up in the streets of El Barrio to walk through a black neighborhood in central Harlem, because I lived in East Harlem, which was mainly Puerto Rico, and walk through black neighborhoods and say, hey, bro, what you putting down, man? Putting down, grabbing, you know, all the feeling, all the, and go to Puerto Rican, and go, oye, panin, ¿cómo está? ¿Qué se dice? And there was nothing to say, oye, hey, because we were picking it all up, this energy. Children are like that. By osmosis, they pick up, hopefully, beauty in this world that's not so mm-hmm. in that sense because of the greed, you know. But that kind of a feeling I've spoken to my own children about, and to other young people, one named Gus, very dear young brother, maybe 8 or 10 years old now. And he, mother's white and his father's black, and he was having this flow of feeling. So I took him for a walk and we talked, and I told him how I felt when I was a child. And he listened. I said, you'd be proud of your beauty. Mm-hmm. No color was meant to be inferior, no more than any other color was meant to be superior, son. You got to look at it. You walk tall, not in arrogance, but with your sense of dignity, which is your beautiful spirit.
Right. But, you know, we live in a society that is fundamentally racial, and so our categories tend to
I'm human. I'm human.
Well, this is the
100%
point.
Human, very beautiful, like a top conglomeration of manifestations of everything that I are. Whatever there is in me, or whatever energy is in me, it's all my beauty. I'm pure in my soul. At least I believe that, and no one can take away that feeling from me. Because I've learned long ago that words can be bullets or butterflies, my brother, and words like minority, which means less than, and it's not in other words for niggers and spicks, we have taken and applied it unto ourselves. I remember when I was a kid, calling each other, hey, nigger, hey, nigger, and still do. Oh, yeah, spick, hey, spick, hey, still do. Words can be bullets or butterflies, so you must say what you mean and mean what you say. That's very important. Minority? We're not minorities. Each one of us is a majority of one. Similar to each other, but like fingerprints and cultures, not quite the same. And that you got to understand very beautifully. Once you understand that you are not just a geographic location or color or sex or sexual preference, but rather an earthling, part of a universe, an earth, hey man, how small can you feel?
So what are the building blocks to that? How do we get to that point when we're so stifled by racism?
We
got to
throw
politics.
Off all the dogmas or whatever the feeling is, because if you notice everyone today, in order to make it, when they get there, hey, I'm number one, I'm number one. They don't want to be number two, and both belong you know where when you pull the chain. We should be talking about, hey, how about we?
Absolutely.
Without me, no me, without you, no you, and without us, no we. Well, we're being so busy in a state of divide and so forth and so on, division. They're beating the brains out. We don't get time to train our children the best education we possibly can to get them out there to take those positions mm-hmm. and those feelings and flows. We're falling into, I've learned that death is not dying in that sense, that death is really a state of apathies and doubts and depressions and all are mal, all are negatives, you know, because I believe that the spirit always lives. We have been, are, and shall be. That's very important to understand that mm-hmm. body is one thing, mind other, spirit other. We've got to do a ballet with each. I don't have any middleman. To me, God is a smile on the face of a child that ain't wasted. like mine's was at one time and yours.
Right,
so many.
Right. You have some poetry about these kind of things. What,
yeah, I like poetry from the energy. I consider myself fundamentally a poet, Aeon. As a child, I was very, very good at playing the dozens, insulting each other's mothers and fathers in perfect rhyme, you know. And I got so good at it, I started getting so many beatings, I decided I would turn my talent to something less violent, in a sense. But I have a feeling about streets and feelings, so I wrote this particular one that says, the street's got its kicks like a bargain shelf. In fact, cool breeze, it's got love like any place else. It's got high-powered salesmen who push mutual junk, and hustlers who can swallow you up in a chunk. And it's got our beautiful children living in all kinds of hell, hoping to survive and making it well. And they're born anew at each AM. Hey, a child out of twilight, flying towards sunlight. Hey, born anew at each AM. Vaya, children, rise above curly chimney and smoke. Hey, suck your belly in and hold your breath and open wide your soulish eyes and behold a rainbow that is you. And drip of a drop, don't you dare name it a tear. It's hard to cry with tears. It's harder without. Hey, to smother your four sobs in silence and bite your fourth finger in helplessness and cry out, hey, God, where's a doctor can cure me? What's the operation's name? Yet believe in yourselves. Doubt not your creativity and beauty and allow no one to doubt for you. Hey, children. Suck your belly in and hold your breath and open wide those soulish eyes and behold the rainbow that is you. Punto.
Punto. Excellent.
Punto. Yes. I've never lost my childlike quality of being. My greatest struggle is to get rid of my childishness.
Mm-hmm. What would you say to somebody who is trapped in the corporate world that is required to have a super adult image and is relied on by a lot of people to do things, to be responsible, to be in control? How did they begin to loosen some of those bonds and begin to get in touch, not just with themselves, but with what that humanity is?
Yeah. Well, that takes making your inner journey into yourself without fear. And without self-justification and check everything out. Hey, do I really want to do this? Because I've asked myself many, many questions along the line. As a child, I was asking the questions of others of what to do with me. And I had to learn how to ask within me of what to do with me myself. Because we all get too busy depending on others and we don't know how to walk tall by ourselves. The idea that we need is a unity. If a person is not happy in doing unity among inside of him, always something like this, because you're always going to have a little jarring in life. It cannot be paradise on earth in that sense of being, but enough to have your karma really flowing. If you're not happy with what you're doing, get out, because it's slow death. Some people stay for the money.
Well, that's it.
I was fortunate enough to have compañera that shared and whatever may we put into the party and so forth and honor, mm-hmm. etc. And it gave me a freedom to be what I wished to deal. I didn't want to be making deals all the time. Mm-hmm. People say, how come you feel so righteous? I said, it's not a matter of being righteous. It's a matter of my being free. For, yeah, I'd done time in Comstock, and I did those 7 years in the maximum security and the whole energy feelings. But my goodness gracious, man, I was not born a criminal from my lovely mother's womb. I was born a beautiful, natural child, just like any other child, into a criminal world of bigotry and beatings and forget it, man, and tolerance. Go ahead. All racism, greed. How about greed? Mm-hmm. See, so I had to learn who I were as a person, who I are. And in prison, because prison is be a very learning place, man, if you don't serve the time and instead make the time serve you. Malcolm did it. Geronimo did it. Mm-hmm. Leonard Peltier doing it, artwork and the whole feeling from the Puerto Rican prisoners, you know. Oh, everyone is doing this creative because when you believe in justice, when you live in peace and you live in dignity, even though your body may be in a prison, your spirit will not serve one once of time. Mm-hmm. For the most cruelest prison of all is the prison of one's mind.
Absolutely. And that comes back to some of the problems that people do face with regards to a kind of ghetto mentality of the mind. In my estimation, it is in the mind. If one cannot escape oneself and not understand that you've got to step outside of yourself, all that you're talking about in terms of discovering your humanity always seems to suggest that one has got to be outside of it. Mm-hmm. That you've got to say, all right, there you are, Ian, you know, let me look at you, let me see what you are. And again, the process is towards making that move, often a sort of wrenching for a lot of people. And then, you know, an intelligent people and look at it and say, well, no, I don't really want to do that. I'll stay with my money, I'll stay with my house. It seems very much that the way our world is going, that people are being pushed into making, thinking these ways anyway. The boxes that we were all caught in are being exploded and connecting with each other. Do you have a word for people trying to make that connection with other groups? Because often people are stifled within their own group and not able often to see what other people are doing and thereby, you know, learn something from them.
Yeah, I can understand that. Look, when I said that that we must learn from each other, I mean, all the tribes, all the colors, we must learn from each other. Otherwise, there will be no us. We'll be constantly slaughter and slaughter and slaughter. All we must do to find out that harsh reality is read our past history, read the destruction of black civilization, read the manifest destiny of so many different nations who thought they had to conquer the world and make new orders, and all they left was constant disorder. But we need now, as the young ones of all the ages, the one who believe in peace and justice and dignity, we have to become a sense of unity among us without forked tongues. We must have smile on our faces that are for real, not smiles that are wasted because they don't match what's in our hearts. We know how to read humans like humans read books. All the children know how to do that. It's just that we ain't had no recourse. Now we must unite in the name of beauty and creativity. All our specialties, all one is doctor, others this, business, whatever, without ripping each other off, because the true name of the enemy of all the children is a breed named greed, and it comes in all colors. That is wisdom's ways. I went my mama's ways many times. Don't think when I made that first step of becoming un bandido, I thought it was all right. The white man done it all his life. I think I could rip off money and the whole feeling from those after-hour joints and put it into the drugs and become a king lord drug set. And that was all the negative dreams of a child of the ghettos. But something in me, that spirit of the child, refused that. And even in prison, man, I would do like what I had learned from wisdom in a little passage about a human energy of beauty named J.C., Jesus, who said, though I'm in this world, I'm not of this world. So while I was in prison, I said, though I'm in this prison, I'm not of this prison, and refused to become behavior modified or institutionalized, and only related with humans and that energy of a pure energy without arrogance, mm-hmm. just a sharing and a caring that was born of a truth. We BS each other today. We lie at the drop of the hat. You see the little children dropping because why? They figure they lie. They avoid a confrontation about something and shouting and so forth. So after a while, your lying becomes very easy. Mm-hmm. And you lie and you lie and you lie and you lie with a smile on your face. But one must learn to read the heart. One little flicker, one little feeling, and you will see the energy of that person knowing that he lies.
That is, I guess, you mean just becoming more conscious of each other. As we talk with each other, we must look.
As majority of one, not to lump everybody together, because only one of these colors or whatever the colors are, red, yellow, whatever the colors are, underneath that skin, you take away the skin and you got corpuscles, red corpuscles and black corpuscles, just like anybody else. But the energy of culture. That's why it's so important that in spite of all the colors and all the feeling, let's put a sense of beauty to it. And then and do a sharing and caring. After all, viva la difference, man. Mm-hmm. It's beauty. I get tired of seeing everything the same. I like differences. I like flowers of different colors and feelings. I am my me. I made that promise to me so many years ago. I got so angry and the rage was so ice cold, man. I got tired of being made to feel like an inferior constantly 100% of the time. For where could I go to hide my beautiful color? And I did not wish to hide it. I did conking of my hair to see make my hair look like Cochise, if not Prince Valiant, until it turned red and began to drop out in all the feelings. And my mother put me to her bosom. She said, "Hey, Negrito, what have you done to your beautiful hair?" I said, "Oh, Mama, I got so tired of being called nappy and raisin head y pelo malo y pasa." She said, no, your hair is beautiful. It is you.
Yes,
it's important that we be proud of each other, of our dignity, and don't allow anyone to make us feel less than, because children become what they are taught. And in the name of love, we the parents are teaching many of our children. Years ago, the parents would say, "Know your place so that you don't get in trouble with the white man and all that stuff." Well, let's get up more in unity, more beautiful, all the colors, all the colors. And do a flow around the whole circle of this earth, because people want truth. They're tired of it. They're tired of all the energy you can see moving, especially the children. Our children are more active today in their intellectuality than they were years ago. When I was a child, they kept this tukutum, and this was as high as you could go. So I salute our children. I salute the children that are here, they're working hard for peace, with justice, equality in the sense of being full of their dignity. I salute them in the name of the children that are to come someday, which are surely going to be their own.
Well, that's another message that you talk very much in your books about, and that is of talking to the children and preparing us as adults with children to think more seriously about the future, about what kind of vision we have for our children, rather than just saying, well, some other generation, somebody else will take care of it.
Nobody
we're just going to get through this kind of... Well, this is the thing. And we're moving now into another century where things will be very different. They could be a lot... They could be the same things made a lot worse. But it's important that this word of humanity and of dignity is carried and projected into the future. Do you have another poem?
I wanted to say that I've been blessed, if you please, to be invited to, over the years, to travel to many different colleges and communities and flows. I didn't like to write a skyline and become political and all that gents. I like to do my flows because the children were the ones that healed me when I was so outraged I always could think of murder. And they healed me, so in turn, I heal them right back. We would have no generation gap between us and the children. We should be tuned, because if we have generation gap, we lose the children. Goebbels, from Nazi Hitler, he said, "Hey, give me your children for the first 10 years. I'll give them back to you, and they'll always belong to the state." Hey, yeah, man, kids were turning in their parents to be shot and receive a medal. So children become what they learn. No, sassy? Let us teach them the beauty. And no matter how heavy that war out there to make it, have some time for family just to give a little sharing and advice and some good huggies. We all need to be assured. It's by a sister. And she called this "And Justice Wept." Ashes smoldered as dark plumes of smoke blotted out the sky. No pot of gold for the rainbow of humanity below. Instead, a cauldron boiled over, spewing mindless mayhem, molten anger. Those there to protect and serve withdrew as victims cried, trembling as she held the scales of justice. Justice cried too. And I'd like to read this one here in honor of all political prisoners, Geronimo Prepp and Le Pertier and all the Puerto Rican brothers and sisters who are in the prisons. And as all the political prisoners who believe in peace and justice, they fully understand that though their body is doing time, that spirit ain't going to do one bit of time at all. This is my brother who I never had the beauty to meet, but we are very tuned together, like you and I, when we have first impressions, because as I told you, we don't have to know each other for 7 years. 7 seconds, it was slow. Mm-hmm. 3 seconds, it was so, and it was faster than light. We'll light up the night with the delight of instant recognition. Hey, that's a brother. Oh, that's a sister. Lanston Hughes. Let America be America again. Let it be the dream it used to be. Let it be the pioneer on the plain, seeking a home where he himself is free. America never was America to me. Let America be the dream is dreamt. Let it be that great, strong land of love where never kings connive nor tyrants scheme that anyone be crushed by one above. It never was America to me. Oh, let my land be a land where liberty is crowned with no false patriotic wreath, but opportunity is real and life is free, equality in the air that we breathe. There never been equality for me, nor freedom in this homeland of the free. Say, who are you that mumbles in the dark? And who are you that draws your veil across the stars? Me? I am the poor white, fooled and pushed apart. I'm the Negro bearing slavery scars. I'm the red man driven from the land. I'm the immigrant crutching the hope I seek and finding only the same old stupid plan of dog eat dog, of mighty crush the weak. I am the young man full of strength and hope, tangled in that ancient endless chain of profit, power, gain, of grab the land, of grab the gold, of grab the ways of satisfying need, of work the men will take the pay, of owing everything for one's own greed. I am the farmer, bondsman to the soil. I'm the worker, sold to the machine. I'm the Negro, servant to you all. I'm the people, worried, hungry, mean. Hungry yet today, despite the dream. Beaten yet today, oh pioneer. I'm the one who never got ahead. The poorest worker, bartered throughout the years. Yet I'm the one that dreamt our basic dream. In that old world, while still a serf of kings, who dreamt the dream so strong, so brave, so true, that even yet its mighty daring sing in every brick and stone and every furrowed turn that made America the land it has become. Oh, I'm the man who sailed those early seas in search of what I meant to be my home. For I'm the one who left dark island shore and Poland's plain and England's grassy lea, and torn from black Africa's strand, I came to build a homeland of the free. The free? A dream still beckoning to me. Oh, let America be America again, the land that never has been yet and yet must be, the land where everyone is free, the land that's mine, the poor man, Indian, Negro, me, who made America, whose sweat and blood, whose faith and pain, whose hand at the foundry, whose plow in the rain, must bring back our mighty dream again. Sure. Call me any name you choose. The steel of freedom does not stain. For those who live like leeches on the people's lives, we must take back our land again. We must take back our land again. Hey, America. Oh, yes, I say it plain. Hey, America never was America to me. We the people must redeem our land, the mines, the plants, the rivers, the mountains, and the endless plains, and all the stretch of those green states, and make America again.
Excellent. Thank you, my brother.
Thank
wonderful,
you, my
wonderful,
brother.
Wonderful.
See, we get together. One and one makes two.